You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Johnson.
The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com. And streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's The Great Escape After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's The Great Escape After Show.
Welcome, everybody. We are here, just like Bing. We're doing another after show for The Great Escape Season 1, Episode 8, Escape from the Swamp. I am, of course, your host, Phil Svitek, joining alongside, as always...
Hello, everyone. It's Marisa Serafini back again.
Yes, and this week we have not Matt Fondelier, but another one of our favorites.
An even better option.
Yes.
Michelle Macedo. Hey, guys, what's up?
Hello, hello.
Hello, welcome back. Thank you.
As the tradition we started last week with Marisa, we each got to pick our own teams, and we rooted for them from start to end. So let's. Why don't we go down the list? Marisa, you picked the green team, Luke and Tim. Why did you choose Luke and Tim?
Well, first of all, I first saw Luke and Tim as the two buff guys who could probably physically endure all the challenges that they had to go through.
I have a question. You better get the best for me.
Thank you for that. They're friends. They're from Chicago, so I kind of had
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. How much was it that they were from Chicago?
My people.
How much did you believe in them, and how much was it that...
Right from the get-go when I saw them, I was like, okay, yeah, I can root for them. They're
You know
cool.
what? Firemen cool. are usually very good. They weren't the typical bros. What?
No, nothing. Keep going.
I'm just saying, well, in the past, you know, we've had the... overconfident duo of guys, and I, you know, these guys were confident, but they weren't overconfident. So I could see why you would pick them.
Yeah.
Well,
you picked the red team.
I picked the red team because they both acknowledged, Paul and Jen, the red team both acknowledged each other's strengths and weaknesses, and they also respected each other. That is something that I saw. The dudes, they both wanted to be the main dude. They didn't want to step back and let one of them lead and one of them, like, kind of follow. And I don't think that they went over their strengths and weaknesses. The other, Davey and Beth, which is like a ball and chain.
All right, well, here's the thing. First off, they get interviewed for so long, so you don't know that they didn't compliment each other, but all right.
No, but I, you do already. The thing is, you know, nothing that they said while they communicated during the whole episode surprised me about any of them. It just solidified my idea of who they were anyway.
All right.
It's amazing.
Well, I picked the blue team of Davey and Beth.
So what made you do that?
Because I felt Davey was strong. And, you know, whereas, with Paul and Jen, I didn't quite see the it factor. I didn't believe that they had what it took to overcome certain obstacles. I felt Davey and Beth were more equipped. And I just didn't believe in Luke and Tim.
I feel like if Beth wasn't there, maybe Davey would be better. But, like... just as a team.
I don't think that's actually true. I think Beth helped them out quite a bit.
Yeah, but just communicating wise, it was just like a mess. That's how their relationship is, clearly.
All right. Well, let's start with the detainment zone. I actually want to talk about it real fast. Just the competition in general. I thought this was the best one so far.
Better than
How so?
okay, there's nothing more, at least from a guy's perspective, there's nothing more fun than, like, a swamp getting muddy and, like, you know, you're in the jungle. You know, there's trees, there's grass.
But getting muddy.
There's slingshots, you know. You have to dig. There's tools. There's bugs. It's awesome. Like, it's a fun guy's competition.
It's dirty and gritty.
Yeah, what?
Such a man sport.
And Phil, you know, I do not believe that one. If you were actually that muddy, that you would enjoy it.
I would actually enjoy it.
You would totally.
Down and dirty.
Would you right, rather that than the Insane Asylum one? They got muddy in that, too.
I didn't like the Insane Asylum was fun, but this was. This was very intense, and it was very open. You could get lost. Like, it was...
And it was during the day. I was kind of upset because we wanted it to be at night.
Yeah.
But it was during the day.
Maybe they wouldn't have been able to film any of it.
Probably not.
Because it's all outside.
It could have been that, plus it's just a little bit dangerous or whatever. But if it was night, it would have been double the fun, but it was really fun.
It was still fun nonetheless. I just wanted it to be at night.
I also, you know, so breaking down by section, I really like the detainment zone. Like, I like the ball and chain. I like that they were tied up. They had to destroy the shack. Like, that, it was a fun detainment zone that, you know, it wasn't as easy as the other ones.
That was a funny one because when they showed the guys at just like throwing the ball and chain on the floor, hoping it would fall through. It's funny because all of them chose such different ways to get out, you know? It's like watching, you know, like mice in a labyrinth. It's just funny. They all did different things.
I like the fact that the ball and chain like carried on to the next stage. Whereas all the other episodes, detainments, like once you're out, you're done and free. But they were still kind of locked and, you know, restricted before, like, as they kept moving on. Mm-hmm. It lasted longer.
I agree. What did you think of your red team strategy?
The red team strategy, he is basically like, oh, she just, like, kicked it down, right? I wouldn't expect that really from that team. I expected that from Davey and Beth. I thought they were just, or even the guys. I thought
Davey and Beth did start kicking it first.
Yeah.
And then why did they?
The blue team
kicked
the walls first.
Oh yeah. And then they were Well, I guess then did the red team find the map first?
Yeah. Red was first, and then the green was second.
So that was a good strategy. Find the map first, then get out. That was a good strategy.
I mean, that was everyone's strategy. Find the map
really
first, then get out.
Just kick it.
But it's just how you actually find the map. And,
but they, like, kicked it right. Yeah. I mean.
We get it. So, Marisa, what about your team strategy? Did you like it?
I liked it. It was pretty simple, you know. They found the map eventually, and they kicked down the walls. I liked it when once they got out. My team, they were, like, running together, but they were chanting, middle, like a boot camp or something.
Wait, what were they saying, middle?
Yeah, like, when they were stepping, like, middle or something.
What does that mean?
Yeah, I don't know, but it sounded
like... Again, they're
the
firemen,
middle.
So they do a lot of
it
these
It sounded like
courses.
An army thing or something.
Yeah, it sounded like they were at army boot camp or something.
Yeah, Chicago's finest.
So for a second, I thought maybe they were in the army together.
No, they're firemen.
Right, I know that, but I'm just saying.
But even firemen, they have, like, structure and training and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that listening to that and watching that, I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, that was cool.
For the blue team, you know, it's one of those things, like, you just hit yourself when it's just so obvious and they just can't find it. But, you know, we'll break it down in terms of what actually lost it or won it for each of these teams. And, you know, in the grand scheme of things, not finding this map wasn't the most detrimental thing to the blue team.
I really feel like it was the getting caught part. I mean, that was like...
It was more of the tools. So, speaking of which, let's just jump right into stage one. And you know what? I will give the green team a lot of credit. I thought theirs was the best strategy.
For the tools.
Yes, I agree, because once the green team got... first of all, they had there was three cauldrons, and they had to dig for tools that had that could free them from the ball and chains. And so the green team, they get the tools, and one of them, I forget which, gets one of them freed from the ball and chain. But while one is freed, the other one went to the cauldron and started digging out the pieces that they needed. So it was like two birds in one stone.
Wait, is the cauldron the one with the crawfish?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. On the car.
Yeah. So I really like that. You know, let's both do something.
Tag team. Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought that was a smart strategy.
Yeah, that was probably the best strategy out of all of them for that, because the other ones.
It was more efficient too.
Yeah. Basically, the other ones, they just like one watched the other do it.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So, I mean, I would have loved to see the ratio of time that I actually did save, but it seemed like it saved a lot of time and it helped them out. And, of course, the red team was second. And, you know, they had a good streak. Now, the one thing I didn't like about the green team is that they tried to take everything, thinking that it would mess up the other teams. And, you know, later on with the blue team, when they finally get there after getting caught a few times, you know, they're like, we don't have the necessary tools. And it was like, wait, did the green team really steal them? Oh, wait, no, they didn't. Because as a producer, you got to allow the tools.
Yeah, there's no way.
There. So,
you can't.
So even if it was stolen, you still have to replenish the tools.
Yeah, that'd be crazy.
But it would, I think, you know.
That's not fair.
Yeah.
Let me ask this. Did that slow them down? Like, if in fact they took more tools than they actually could have, did it slow down the green team? Because now they're carrying, A, all these potatoes, B, all these tools. And it's like, what?
That's what I thought. I thought them carrying more stuff that they needed was actually going to slow them down and be their, you know, their Achilles heel. But I don't think it was really a factor for that.
All right. Well,
we're talking about the blue team?
The
green team taking all the tools.
Oh.
you know what was actually a big factor, and yet, it was a huge factor. It was the guards. But for as many guards as there were, and as many times as the teams got caught, the red team didn't actually get caught. They were the only ones that actually stayed safe. But for the green and blue team, certainly the blue team.
It was all like open fields, so, and they all have really bright t-shirts on.
Yeah.
So the red team stayed low to the ground, which was smart.
But still, for as many guards as there were, not a lot of people were actually caught so many times. You know what I mean? Like it was a huge determining factor, but eventually people wised up and it slowed down their game.
Yeah, eventually though.
Eventually.
It was like funny because they were like, the first thing they said was like, oh, man, I didn't think that they'd have them right when we got out. And I was like,
yeah, they were like literally right next to the shack and get caught.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, here, let's step 5 feet back into the building.
Yeah.
The shack thing.
And the thing that made it very unsafe was that no stage was safe. Usually when you get to a stage, it's, okay, we can think about this. We can strategize. This is the safe zone.
Mm.
There was no safe zone.
Oh yeah, there wasn't.
So it was a different element to the game, and you just had so many guards. And again, I don't know how the Bloodhounds came into
play.
Yeah,
they weren't needed.
That was like so for the
really
like visual aspect, like
hunting
intense
kind of thing,
dogs.
Like
yeah,
hunting dogs.
Yeah, you know those dogs that are trained to like look for people.
Yeah. The canine units.
Again, it's just one of those things. You as a guard, you know where they're going. You know their goals. Maybe on purpose they don't tell you. But again, you know if you see a camera guy, there's probably a good chance that they're somewhere.
Well, I wonder if they like hide everything. I mean, they have to.
I don't think the people running the camera are down on the ground crawling with the teams, you know.
Yeah.
They're not gonna do that.
Right.
We've said
so
from the get-go, it's the Legends of the Hidden Temple, like, hey, you just, as a guard, you just have to dumb yourself down.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you really wanted to catch them, like, you could.
Yeah.
I think they're just trying to put them under more pressure and stress them out even more.
Yeah.
And then see if they crack under that.
I think the guards are really there just for entertainment and
And for suspense. Yeah, exactly. Suspense.
That's it.
Totally.
But that's entertaining.
Yeah, exactly. It makes us scared, totally.
Yeah,
then
it makes the game fun.
Yeah. It puts an urgency on it.
I love how all the teams kind of got past this one guard behind his back.
Right? You're just standing there and, like, they'll literally...
Yeah, because I guess, like, not every... Yeah, they just can't get all of them.
So, let's talk about Cypress Grove. The really eerie...
Is it the voodoo doll?
Stage yeah. two, yeah.
I gotta get that sound effect. Stage two.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we should work on that for the final.
Yeah.
Allie. I'll get on that.
yeah, they all had interesting tactics to get the voodoo dolls down.
Yeah.
Like, I...
take the slingshots and hit down the voodoo...
And the green team got it on the first try, though, didn't they? The slingshots?
No, they didn't.
It took a while.
The blue team...
The red team was pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
At this point, it was all just based on good... eye-hand coordination. Whoever hit them down
also,
first.
Yeah. You had the bullets, or whatever you would want to call them, that were there.
The ammo. So,
yeah, and that was Davey and Beth. They used those. Whereas you could also use the potatoes, and the potatoes obviously gave you... You at least were given a choice, and I think with the potato, you can just hit the voodoo doll, and that has a greater impact versus these tiny little rocks, and you're going for a string.
I would have just taken the potatoes and chucked them.
Yeah.
To hell with the slingshot, just throw them.
Yeah, unless you have, like, really good aim.
Right.
And you know how to do it.
And, you know, they're not too far. They're only...
Well, here's the thing. You have better aim with a slingshot. And B, it's going to be faster. You're going to have more impact. But yes, go ahead, Marisa.
But do you? True. But the potato's bigger.
So. It depends.
Okay. And I still urge you to do it. Go ahead. We'll play this game in real life.
Again, I would have just taken the potatoes and throw them.
Yeah.
But that was just me.
Yeah. So the red found that first. I don't mean to brag, but
did. I love the masochist that is Paul, and then Jen.
I know exactly. That's what I think is hilarious about it is that the reason why it works is because he just surrenders to it, and he just knows. Like he said in the interview, she's the brains, and then I was waiting for him to be like, and I'm the good looks or something, even like something funny or like. Anything, and he was like, but she's just the brains.
And he said
he follows.
Yeah, exactly.
He said he's here to break stuff.
Oh, yeah. He said I don't know if that'd be considered a skill, but I guess.
Hey, if you're good at it, sure.
Yeah.
You know, it was weird. It was the green team that was ahead, and the red team was behind them. And because the green team, I felt like it stemmed from the fact that they didn't want the red team up there, for lack of a better word, ass. They diverted away, and therefore the red team got to Cypress Grove faster.
Yeah, because they were neck and neck, and the green team actually backed down and slowed their game down, and then the red team got ahead.
You think the green team did that on purpose?
I think they did it on purpose. They didn't know that.
I think they slowed down the game just to like get the red team off their backs.
Yeah, but I don't think they necessarily didn't stop going towards, Cypress, the stage two.
What would be, like, besides it being, like, awkward, what would be the, like, so bad about being, like, next so close to another team?
Just getting caught, and I think they were overthinking it again at that point,
Like psyching themselves out?
Yeah, just collectively get to stage two, and then, you're going to each do your own thing. At the end of the day, you have to know there's going to be a separating factor, and you just have to find that opportunity. And even if you don't know what stage two is, just continue and just go with them,
Mm-hmm.
And if you honestly think that they're leading you down a bad path, that's stupid for the other team, and you know what, then just veer off at that point towards the correct stage two or whatever it may be.
Yeah.
So just overthinking it, I think, for the green team.
Mm.
Let's talk about, just wrap up stage one with the blue team, my team, and how...
They got sent back twice.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, but that was
the... I like the second time they got sent back, because they were just, like, literally, like, crouching down in the middle, like, of the open field, hoping that the guards wouldn't see them. I'm like, that's not going to help you.
Yeah, oh my God.
That's like covering your eyes and say, you can't see me.
Totally.
But the struggling part was them trying to get their shackles off.
What happened? Did they just jump the gun in terms of they were like, oh, these are all the tools we have, and so he just tried to do it with that one tool set, and then she saw the other tool set?
Yeah, the pliers.
Well, you learn a lot about, you know, A, it stems from, okay, we didn't take the time to scope out the surrounding area.
Yeah, they, like, panicked.
B, you're jumping to conclusions thinking that everyone else is cheating.
Yeah.
So it just kind of reveals who you are as a character, you know, and I'm not saying that's a bad trait, but it's certainly a defensive / cautious person.
It's like extra energy that.
Yeah, but the thing is, the blue team, they spent too much time trying to get out of the ball and chain. They didn't take a moment to take a look around.
Yeah, I know.
Look 10 feet to their left or whatever. And be like, oh my gosh, there's another toolbox.
She had, like, you know how there's always that one team where, like, one of them has, like, commentary during the whole thing? They're just always talking. That was Beth, and it was hers was really funny because she'd be like, I don't know where it is. There's no more tools. I know. Oh, wait, there's a toolbox right there. And it was like she would freak out and say that she, like, had no idea. Mm-hmm. And just like in the cemetery, you know? And then she would actually be able to, like, see. And then she was like, go, honey.
To borrow a quote from Smart Guy, with 5%
more. Wow, Smart Guy.
With 5% more effort, you can get 50% more results. And clearly they were just jumping the gun.
Wow, you really paid attention during that show.
Yes.
Wow.
Oh, that's a good quote. I just always remember that quote.
It is a good one.
With 5% more effort, you can get 50% more results.
Very, yeah.
And essentially, it just means slow your game down, look,
exactly.
And then you know what's happening, and that's it.
Exactly.
And essentially, this is what really lost it for the blue team. Because after that, they were golden. You know, they weren't doing too bad.
Yeah, it was kind of smooth sailing from there on for them afterwards.
Let's talk about stage three, and this is where the green team did get caught, and had they not, perhaps they would have won.
I think
this is what really broke it down for the green team.
The cemetery. And so they had to go, and they had to put, it says something about four corners, and they have to get the date or whatever off the cemetery by putting
people,
the crayon thing or whatever.
Yeah. Paper to the four corners, and they had to rub the candle next to it that revealed the date, which I think this was their version of decoding.
Yeah.
Because all the other episodes, like, you have to look at images or some kind of decoding or decrypting kind of thing, and this was, like, their little version of it.
And I'm glad you say that, but it's also different in the sense, like, okay, you're not memorizing this to open a combo. If you really want, as the green team did, you could just start digging, and eventually you'll find something.
Yeah.
Well, that's what was funny about the blue team, and not to backtrack, but I just really want to point out the entertainment value of them taking all of the crawfish out of the cauldron rather than everybody else who just, like, put their hand in and found it in, like, a second. He just, like, put all of his energy into, like, emptying it out. Like, I so did not expect that.
And again, a waste of time.
Exactly, yeah,
really?
Waste of time.
Really? You think that was a waste of time?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Did you see how long it took the other people?
While.
It took them, like, a second once. And everyone made
but
the guy and the team do it.
They physically got into the cauldron and dug around.
And they just dealt with, like, being scratched.
Yeah.
And this guy was, like, funny. You thought of it backwards.
In hindsight, you know, again, I like the green team strategy, but I guess in some sense.
Captain Hindsight.
Yes, Captain Hindsight. One person could have been taking out those things while the other person could have been searching the cauldron. Therefore, you're decreasing what's in the cauldron while searching.
What do you mean?
Anyway, I'll let that sink in.
But still, I think it was a waste of time and energy. Are you kidding
me? Well, the way they did it, yes.
It was not necessary.
I'm saying the way they did not do it the way I just described it. So, yes, I agree with
that. Oh, right.
All right. So, before we fully move on from the cemetery, I just want to take this quick message to say, hey guys, thank you guys for listening. We are almost wrapped with season one, and we really do appreciate your comments, your ratings, everything like that. And you know, it just hit me today. AfterBuzz is ready to explode in the next month or so because of all the fall lineup shows. And you who are listening to this right now are part of the Cool Kids Club because you were there from pretty much inception. Like, right now, it's still we're still at the beginning phases of AfterBuzz. And then the next few months or so, things are going to really hit even further. And then everyone's going to be saying, oh, my God, AfterBuzz, AfterBuzz. And what you're not going to want to happen is, I actually been listening to AfterBuzz for months now.
Yeah.
Everyone's going to say, yeah, right. Why? You know.
Sure you have.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, it's like knowing about the band before anybody else knows
right,
about
it's
it.
Like, exactly. I knew this song before
it's like,
I got
oh,
big.
You haven't heard that?
So here's how you verify that. Right. First off, you got to start telling your friends now because then they'll be like, wait, what is this? And they'll be like, this is pretty cool. And you're the one who turned them on to it. And
yeah.
B,
so
you got to rate
cool.
and comment on iTunes because that's a timestamp, baby. That'll say the date that you
yep.
commented.
That's proof. That's proof. That's
proof.
True.
Yeah. So get on that because you're going to want to know the proof of being the cool kid.
You guys want to be
yes.
in Phil's Cool Kid Club. Well.
So you have to go to iTunes, search AfterBuzz TV, The Great Escape. And right there you can rate and comment.
And if you're doing it because of this show right now, just end the message with Cool Kid Club.
Yes.
There you
we
go.
Be a part of the Cool Kid Club. Awesome.
All right. Stage three of the cemetery. You know, I like this part of it because this is where everyone kind of caught up. You know, there's...
Yeah, it was kind of getting on an even playing field.
Yeah, they stopped, like, getting caught.
Yeah.
Do you think that maybe it's because it's, like, that's too frustrating for, like, the audience...
Yeah.
Like, you
like
know.
What's the point?
Yeah.
If they keep getting caught? Yeah.
Yeah.
I get that.
Like, that would just be annoying.
Yeah.
And then also you can see that they're if they're catching up to each other, then you're like, oh, wait, who's going to win?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, you know, so this is, as I said, this is where the game became very, very close. And I don't know what it was about the red team, how they were able to just jet out of there so fast and get through, you know, as you guys said, like, this was a great chance for the red team to actually get caught. They hadn't gotten caught yet.
I kind of thought they were going to get caught.
Yeah.
Because they have red shirts. But this is why. Remember? And he was like...
So green team would have had an advantage.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, I thought that because green team, they're out in the grass, you know, but no...
Wait, but are you guys talking about the stage where
the
that
cemetery.
Girl...
Going to the fishing alligator
yeah.
part.
So it's
but
when the girl...
They have to go through the marsh, the open
yeah.
marsh.
Yeah, so, but when the girl figured out to get the buoy thing...
Well, that's stage four.
Stage four. We're still in
that,
stage...
Oh.
We're en route to stage four.
Oh, okay,
we're transitioning.
But we can talk about stage four, so go ahead. I like the red team strategy.
Well, I was just going to say that... she is really smart, and she just figured out to attach it to the pole. And clearly that guy can totally rely on her intelligence, and it totally worked. But
yeah.
then she, like, almost dropped the pole.
Which...
no, they say that they throw it back into the water. They threw it. How far did you throw it?
I know.
Oh, wait. Yeah. It just went... It's actually still there. It's just the top end is in the water. But
okay, can I just say for before the red team even gets to the stage four, the fishing part, the Jen trips.
Oh,
be like,
that's
oh
funny.
My god!
Oh yeah, she ate.
So
oh
dramatic.
Yeah, that was really funny.
Oh my god!
She was like, oh my god, oh my god, I fell. Oh, that was really funny, actually. And he's like,
oh, my God, it was hilarious.
She's like, pick me up, pick me up. He's like,
well, you know what? Because a lot of the contestants do listen.
That was hysterical.
Here's what I think it is. She just got caught in that situation, and yes, here's the thing. The editing made it more.
Yeah,
worse.
The editing. Yeah.
Like they chose that as a cliffhanger of like, oh my God, is she gonna be all right? Is she?
Yeah.
Not?
Did she like break her foot or something?
No, it was a slow mo fall. Oh.
Yeah, that was funny.
Pretty much.
I was thinking because they kept shooting, they kept going to shots of alligators and spiders and snakes. That I was thinking maybe someone was gonna like get bit. You know.
Yeah,
I thought
they always kind of show that.
Yeah,
B-roll.
Yeah,
B-roll.
Definitely.
And this is it actually got a lot more closer than I thought. Because as soon as the green team got there, you know, I don't know who thought of it, but it was a smart idea to use it like them, like a spear. Now, I don't know if they looked right next to them and they were like, oh wow, they used it like a spear.
Yeah.
We should probably use ours like a spear, but.
But they got it on, like, the first try, right? The green team?
The green team, they figured that out faster than the red team. They're like, oh, just, like, attach it.
Yeah.
Make it a spear.
They figured that
done.
Out.
The blue team got it the first time, but they were using it as a fishing pole.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, I really like that part of it. I really wanted it to come down to a full-on race in the river. With canoes and paddling. Mm-hmm.
It was kind of turning into that because, like, that guy teased before the commercial break. He was like, the only thing standing between you and $100,000 is paddling skills.
Well, yeah.
I thought the green team maybe, like, are you kidding? Those two guys are going to, like, paddle the shit out of the water. But
well, most transport zones, as soon as you get to them, it's pretty much a guaranteed win for the most part.
Yeah.
But I thought maybe because that's kind of the way they were acting, that maybe that wouldn't be the case.
And I thought so, too, and I liked that about it. And ultimately...
Oh, because he fell, too.
Yeah. That's
right.
That would have been funny had he lost.
Pretty clumsy with that, right?
Yeah,
man.
That was funny.
I tell ya.
He was about to fall in the water and drop it.
And just drop all your pieces.
I know.
Oh,
credit to him.
Imagine. Sucked.
Yeah.
He was. He knew. He knew not to drop it. And I think even if he went all the way down, like even if it sunk him, he still would have been like, "I got the bag."
Right. Like.
Yeah.
Bag over the water, but his whole body's in the water.
Yeah. Exactly. Then he would have to like climb up, and he was already talking about how his arms were like hurting.
Yeah.
He's.
No, but I give the. I mean, the guy really. He really didn't say much, but he did a lot. And again, she's the brains, but he was the mascus who just did.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's why they were such a good team.
They were. And of course, they won, so congratulations.
And so they're going to
red team, congratulations.
Furnish
your
their
team.
House or something.
Yeah.
Or
right.
Like buy a new house or something. Good for you.
So, yes.
You know what? Actually, I wanted that team to win anyway because that's the only team where it benefits, like, both of them. Like, Davey was just going to give it to his mom, I guess. And then the other dudes were going to, like, go to Croatia. And that's cool.
With their seven-year-olds.
But with their seven, like, yeah. And that's cool. But, like, you can save up money. It's not like, you know, I want the couple to have their house more.
Yeah.
You know? It's
no,
like
they were good. They were good.
Yeah.
And ultimately, they were the deserved winners.
Yeah. You know, I did like the red team. They were good. They were very encouraging of each other.
Mm-hmm.
Not like last week's episode where everyone was like, F this, F that, F you.
Oh, my
blah,
God.
Blah, blah.
Really?
It was terrible. But so, like, I think all the teams, for the most part, were pretty good.
Supportive.
Yeah, supportive. Even when the blue team, when they got on each other immediately afterwards, she's like, oh, I love you, honey. You're awesome.
I know.
So.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
What do we got, Marisa? Escape from the tower next week?
Escape from the tower. I have no idea which tower. But some tower.
From some sort of tower. I guess that means they're going to have to jump out windows and stuff.
That'd be cool.
Perhaps deal with alligators.
You know, I like how they always kind of kept it to something pretty interesting. So, I don't know. I'm excited.
Season finale. So, it's going to be epic. Right?
Why couldn't they do full 10 episodes? I would like to see full 10.
Yeah. To end it at 9, that's such a weird number.
Yeah, that's kind of... Maybe they were just seeing how it did. Who knows?
But at 9.
Maybe someone got bitten by a snake and they didn't air it.
You're like, okay, yeah.
We're not going to show that.
They don't have... I'm checking out their website right now. They don't have the description for the new one yet.
Right now,
we're still on a future episode, Escape from the Swamp. That is a past episode, people.
It is now in the past.
They better update that now.
yeah, come on.
Anyway, I'm excited. I'm excited for the season finale. It's going to be a lot of fun, I think, no matter what it brings. We here have a tradition, Michelle. Where would you like the teams to escape from if you could pick a location?
If I could pick any location... Yes. It would be somewhere in, like, the middle of, like, a blizzard or something. That would be cool.
Okay. That seems fun. Cool. That's a first one. We haven't heard that one yet.
Yeah.
Like an ice storm thing. Pretty original. You're dealing with, like, the cold, too.
Like the Iditarod?
Yeah. Iditarod.
Yeah. Yeah. Like that.
That's cool.
Yeah. All right. Very I dig cool. that. Anyway, where can we
what
find
about you guys?
Guys?
What about you guys?
We've already said ours. We're going to just repeat the hell out of ours if we continue.
Oh. You know, I have a new one. I'd like to see, like, kind of like the Underground Railroad type
that
of
would
thing.
Be cool. Like with rats and stuff.
Like Civil War, Harriet Tubman kind of thing.
That'd be cool. That'd be cool.
All right.
You're going off the American type of thing.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
There you go.
Classic American.
All right.
Yeah.
And for those of you who don't know, Michelle is an amazing musician. Where can they find music?
Thank you, Phil.
If you want to practice Great Escaping. Great Escaping.
at Macedo Music. They could check it out on iTunes. Just Macedo, M-A-C-E-D-O, Flags and Boxes. Check it out.
Nice.
Very cool. And Marisa, where do we find you if they want to continue the conversation?
I am at Marisa Movies, M-A-R-I-S-A Movies, and I'm in the booth. I'm here all the time. That's
right
awesome.
On. So, on behalf of all of us, see you for the finale next week.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.